Welcome back. Are we ready for more trends?
Yes.
That is what I like to hear. We're going to follow the same format as we followed in the first session, just no introduction this time, so we can go straight into the trends. I have two mega trends with some sub trends underneath. I'm going to give you a chance to talk about them and then maybe do a little bit of ideating at the end as well. So I hope you are still have your brains switched on for Age of Healing and Metaphysical, and of course for the light bulb moments. So let's get right to it. I'm going to start with Age of Healing. This is obviously our third, you know, big theme. Of course, you don't need me to tell you, health and well-being is has been top of everybody's minds quite a bit for the past couple of years. But of course, healthcare in general is a big business. One thing I just wanted to highlight is that global digital healthcare funding increased 79% year on year between 2020 and 2021, reaching $57.2 billion. Obviously, not all of the companies that are being funded will eventually make it to market. Some of these products are going to fail. They're just going to fall by the wayside. But some of them are definitely going to succeed. So the news is, you know, a lot more digital health tech in the future. We're already starting to see a lot of that happening now, but be prepared for a lot more to happen. And of course, look, big players are getting involved in healthcare. They're starting to turn the devices that we are already wearing and using into healthcare devices. You can track your steps or lack of steps some days, the flights of stairs you've walked up. If you've got a newer Apple Watch, you can also track your heart rate. Apple actually did a big sort of promotion in January this year, which is Heart Health Month, where they provided lots of information to people about improving their heart health. You could do little challenges. There was just lots of general information about it. So they're really pushing into healthcare in a big way. They're not the only sort of big tech company that are doing that. Lots and lots of the big tech companies, Google, for example, are also sort of pushing into the healthcare space. I also think it's just important to note that many of these devices don't just allow us to track our steps or, you know, those kinds of very basic metrics. Some of them are actually getting very, very sophisticated. So the Amazon Halo is a sort of tracking band from Amazon. Now, a little caveat here, because obviously talking about Amazon, you know, they're definitely a brand that divides opinion. So when I tell you what this does, you might have an opinion on it. But basically, the tracking band has a listening device embedded into it. So it means that during the day when you are speaking, it basically listens to your tone of voice. So it allows the band to basically learn things about your emotions throughout the day. So when are you happy? When are you sad? When are you elated? When do you have a, you know, when are you hesitant, for example? And it collects all of that information to give you insights about your mental health, your mental state. So we're moving from, you know, not just information about our metrics, but also, information about our emotions. Now, I'm not necessarily this is a good idea. I'm not sure if I would be using one of these, but hey, I'm just saying, you know, we're starting to see the technology develop in this kind of way. And of course, that's because when we think about health and well-being, we don't just think about physical fitness. Obviously, that is a very important component of it, but health is, you know, this holistic package today. You know, we also think about sleep, mindfulness, mental health, of course. And in fact, you know, mental health is actually often thought of as being more important when it comes to health than physical health is. And I think sort of living through the last couple of years, you know, through a pandemic where we've had to really, you know, grapple with some really big shifts and big changes has really started to push mental health, you know, much higher onto the agenda. There's also a decreasing stigma around accessing help for mental health. Some brands are helping to push it mainstream. Before the pandemic, before the WHO got a little bit, you know, preoccupied with other things, they had time to think about things like burnout. And in 2019, they classified burnout as an official health issue, basically. So their official diagnosis, which I feel is a little wordy, they could have done a bit better here, a syndrome conceptualized as resulting from chronic workplace stress that has not been successfully managed. So basically people are, you know, stressed at work, it's not being managed properly, it's resulting in burnout. That has, you know, implications for their mental health. And of course, this was before the pandemic. Well, then we all just lived through an event that definitely cured burnout, right? Right, no. So of course you're still seeing, you know, the mental health issue, you know, become more and more topical. Also, interestingly, and you know, sorry, this is also not the most cheerful thing to talk about, but also particularly amongst young people, you know, the AA, the American Association of Psychiatrists, declared a national health emergency in child and adolescent mental health last year. They are really quite concerned about the problem. Another study from the CDC, which is actually from this year, shows that eating disorders among teen girls doubled during the pandemic. Increased visits related to behavioural health amongst children aged 5 to 17. So, you know, look, young people are sort of struggling with their mental health as well. And I think this really is going to have long-term implications, you know, not just a problem that we need to solve now. But of course, are we actually solving the problem very well now? I think in some cases, the answer is no. All 50 states are struggling to empower schools amid a worsening mental health crisis. Only Idaho and Washington exceed the nationally recommended ratio of one school psychologist for every 500 students. So, you know, many young people are maybe not getting the help that they need. And, you know, that obviously is, like I just said, going to have really long, far-reaching implications. But this is all getting a little bit doom and gloom. I don't want you to kind of leave with that impression, because I do think it's not all bad news, you know. A new narrative is emerging. I'm sure you remember at the Tokyo 2020 Olympics, which were confusingly in 2021. That's going to confuse people for a long time in the future, isn't it? Simone Biles, you know, pulled out of events there, putting her mental health first. And I think it's really interesting because she didn't play the role she was meant to play, you know. She said, actually, you know what, like, I'm going to put myself first. I'm going to do what I need to do. She chose to do what was right for her. Many people are looking for more agency and more control. And we touched on that a little bit when we talked about the more mindful consumption, you know. I also think people are also thinking more mindfully about their mental health and what is good for me and what do I need from life and how do I define success? Obviously, you know, Simone Biles was already incredibly successful. She didn't need more medals to tell us that, but she chose to sort of step away from doing that. That was her definition of success. And that's maybe something just really interesting to think about, to take into the future of, you know, how we define success and what we take from life and how we define it. So to kind of go back to where we started this trend, talking about the age of healing, the first sub-trend I have to talk about today is brand care. So of course, you know, we've seen events of the last 2 years create a new health economy, but really people now expect almost every brand they come into contact with to be a healthcare brand and to prioritise their and their friends and families' physical and mental well-being. So of course we saw this during COVID. You know, we thought when we went to the grocery store, what was Walgreens doing to keep us safe? What was Target doing to keep us safe? You know, we didn't really maybe think about that in the past. So we started to see this, you know, mindset shift around what we thought of when we thought of brands. And that's really going to continue. You know, we're not going to dial back those thoughts about brands. People are going to keep expecting all sorts of brands to care for them in various different ways. And of course, there's lots of definitions of care. Lots of brands also during the pandemic, you know, pivoted to making PPE or making hand sanitizer with varying degrees of success, it should be said. But they stepped in, they stepped up, and I think that also played into the mindset. So let's look at a few examples of brands who are providing, you know, new sorts of care. And my first innovation is from Nike. So they very recently launched Nike Mindsets, which is a movement series designed to improve users' mental health. So obviously Nike is very much involved in sport, so them thinking about people's health isn't really that much of a leap. But them thinking about people's mental health is something new for the brand. And they are really highlighting the link between physical health and movement and mental health, encouraging people to move, not just because they're going to lose weight or it's because it's going to make them healthier, but also because it is better for their mind. And they have lots and lots of things on the app where you can track how exercise makes you feel. And also you can do runs, or you can do other kinds of exercises with sort of meditation practice built into it as well. So they're really thinking about that link between physical health and mental health. And there is also, you know, strong scientific evidence that does link those two as well. And just thinking about mental health here, lots and lots of companies are also thinking much more about the mental health of their staff. And of course, we talked in the last session about Glassbox brands and how the way you treat your staff, you know, tells the world something about you. So this is a good example of these two trends sort of bumping up against each other. And I also wanted to include it because it's not a big sort of flashy global brand. They're called Banano Concepts. Maybe I'm saying that right, but they're a small restaurant chain in Denver. They just have 10 restaurants. And they realized, and we talked a little bit already about the Great Resignation, and they were struggling to both keep staff and attract staff. So they thought, what can we do? You know, how can we help solve this? So they actually put out a survey with current staff and also with people they were interviewing, asking them, you know, what's the most important thing for you when you are looking for a job? Is it pay? Is it security? And so on. And the answer that came back top was mental health. So what they decided to do, because they thought, what's the connection between, you know, restaurant work and mental health? How can we improve that? So they've actually hired a therapist that works across all 10 of their restaurants. She travels between all of them and basically provides mental health support for staff. It's free, it's confidential. Obviously, people who work in restaurants are often, you know, working with lower wages on a lower income. They might not actually be able to afford this kind of access themselves. Small companies, particularly like informal economy companies like this, don't always look after their staff in this way. So it's another example of, you know, providing care. And also fits nicely with the trend we talked about before. But obviously we've talked so much about mental health and the pandemic. Perhaps it's easy to think, okay, well, you know, yes, look, this is a sort of a crisis now, but, you know, we're kind of coming out of this. We're not wearing masks today, right? I flew from the UK, you know, we're life is normal, if I can still use that word. But look, future crises are coming. You know, we just talked a little bit, or someone on the panel touched on, you know, the issue in Ukraine and Russia. War, basically, not an issue. People are also, you know, concerned about climate change. 45% of young people said anxiety and stress over the climate crisis was really affecting their daily life. They think that the future is frightening. They think that governments aren't doing enough. You know, young people are concerned about climate change. And obviously as well, a couple of people today have touched on, you know, climate migration and how that might affect the area. What is it going to be like when you think in the future that you might have to move your home and uproot your whole life because of climate change and climate migration? You know, people might also need not just housing and obviously basic human needs, but they might also need mental support as well in the future to sort of deal with these crises that we're going to unfortunately sort of keep having to deal with. And at the moment I'm not really seeing, you know, a great deal of brand activity around sort of climate anxiety. You know, there's lots of news surveys sort of starting to talk about this thing. The only thing I've really seen, and it's sort of a bit of a band-aid fix if I'm honest, Silk are a B Corp, they're a plant-based food brand. Last year on Earth Day, they turned Earth Day into Earth Month, and they started providing eco-anxiety classes online for people. So they had classes with special kinds of therapists who sort of specialize in anxiety and depression related to, you know, the end of the world, dare I say it. they gave tips on how to, you know, what you can do to create change. So it was just a short-term campaign. So like I say, a bit of a band-aid fix. It's not really gonna, you know, solve collective climate anxiety. But by starting to think about how they can turn climate warriors into climate warriors, they're putting more of a positive spin on it, you know, giving people skills and tools. So it's definitely a step in the right direction. And I think there's a lot to explore in this area. Obviously, talking about mental health as well, touched on the pandemic, sort of touched on future crises. Another thing to think about, particularly in industrialised societies, is loneliness. One third of the population in industrialised countries experience feeling lonely. One in 12 experience loneliness at a level that could cause serious mental health problems. This is research that was just published in the British Medical Journal at the start of this year. So look, you know, loneliness. I mean, perhaps some of us here, you know, have experienced it over the past couple of years as well, and it does have really serious health implications. Obviously, tackling loneliness is sort of kind of tricky, and there's a very sort of personal and individual response to loneliness. But when you're thinking about building communities and building places, I definitely think that this is something that can be sort of woven into it. And a couple of examples just to show you here. So this is how a supermarket in the Netherlands is approaching it. They're called Jumbo. So they're a sort of local supermarket chain. And I actually put this one in as well because I just wanted to show a really simple, low-tech innovation. They have designated 200 of their cash registers across their stores as checkout chats, where you basically, you don't just beep, 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 go, beep, like with your shopping. You are, the cashier is actually there to like have a chat with you about whatever you want, whether it's, you know, I'm British, so we'd definitely start with the weather, right? but you know, whatever you want to talk about. Now, obviously, this is not the checkout lane you use if you're in a hurry, you've got a screaming child with you, right? Like, this is for, like, you know, quite specific use cases. They have put it in areas with high levels of loneliness. That's where they've started off. The Dutch government did some research into loneliness across the Netherlands, and they've started implementing these in areas where that was identified. The other thing to think about here as well is, you know, a lot of the sort of narrative around checkouts at the moment is how checkouts are being replaced with cashierless checkouts, basically. You know, Amazon are really sort of pushing, there they are again, are really pushing that kind of technology. You know, there's lots and lots of those kinds of cashierless stores coming into cities. You know, it's going to be the future. They're also being pushed as well, cashierless checkouts, in more sort of rural areas. Perhaps this can be a way that, you know, tech and cashierless can be combined. You know, maybe you can just have, you know, cashierless options where if you are in a hurry and you just need to purchase your toilet paper and leave, you don't need to chat with someone about it. You've got the cashierless option. But if you are, you know, someone that is lonely, there is also another option there. So maybe it's an interesting way to think about how, you know, technology and the human response can live alongside each other, and how we can free up people's time in a way that can also solve social issues. So there's a lot to kind of think about with this innovation that actually looks quite simple on the surface. And one other thing that I just wanted to share with you as well is that loneliness often comes from feeling like you don't really belong, or that you don't really have a place in society. And that's particularly true for people who are maybe trans or identify as LGBT, or, you know, something that, you know, is what we might consider to be, you know, some kind of other. They feel like they don't have a place to belong. So this is a really interesting collective in Chicago called Onward. So they're really trying to promote skateboarding for people who are not your traditional skateboarder, i.e., you know, young, male, white. They have a really diverse group of people who want to practice skating, who are trying to lower the barriers of entry to skating. So they have weekly meetups and things like that. So they're starting to build a community. But the other thing that they're also doing is they've developed sort of mobile skateboarding ramps so that they can bring pop-up skate parks to different areas of the city, so that they can start to engage with new parts of the community, that they can start to reach out to other people. And this innovation also, as well as loneliness, you know, also plays into the idea of, you know, stereotypes are being broken down. You know, the kind of traditional stereotypes you might think about when it comes to skateboarding, like I said, you know, young, male, is being eroded. And that is happening in lots and lots of different ways. You know, just because you are female, that doesn't mean to say that you have to like, you know, shoes and shopping. You can like those things, but you can also like, you know, conventionally male things, like, I don't know, boxing, or I can't actually think of any now, that's not very helpful. But so we're seeing this, you know, breakdown of sort of traditional gender norms as well. So are you sensitive to how culture is changing and how sort of culture and loneliness and belonging can all be embedded into place, and the ways that they can also contribute to improved health, not necessarily physical health, but mental health with physical health following. And of course, I should just also finish by acknowledging that sometimes the definition of care can be much more literal. You know, sometimes we actually just need some care because the infrastructure or, you know, those kinds of things aren't actually in place. So my final innovation for this trend is from Theraflu. Theraflu are owned by GSK. They have put together a $150,000 rest and recover fund, which encourages people to take a sick day when they're needed. Because what they found was that lots and lots of low-income workers actually don't take sick days when it's needed. They go to work, they make themselves sicker, they make other people unwell. Obviously, this is, you know, not including, you know, sort of general legislation or regulation around COVID, but with things like flu. And then, you know, it's kind of a vicious cycle. So they've actually made this fund that people can apply for. And they actually did a big study as well that sort of linked social injustice and sort of taking time off, and are trying to sort of bridge the gap between some of those things. So there we have it. Brand care. When it comes to caring for consumers' health, there are endless opportunities to explore, including many overlooked by governments. Could your forward-thinking brand care solutions go beyond the obvious? Could partnerships help you bring them to the people they would benefit? And also, you know, what else do we think about when we think about health more in general? You know, bringing people together, creating a sense of belonging and things like that. So lots and lots to think about with this trend. And then for my second trend, I'm just going to talk a little bit about cities and how that links to the health of its inhabitants. So of course, you know, over the last couple of years, we saw governments and healthcare professionals advocate the benefits of outdoor activities during lockdowns. But access to green spaces is actually, you know, an inequality issue. You know, many sort of lower socioeconomic groups, there's less tree canopy, they have, you know, less access to green spaces, maybe they are unable to drive to green spaces. So there is this kind of, you know, issue, this sort of economic issue that is linked to green equality. And it's important because there's so much evidence that shows how green spaces is linked to good mental health. And I feel like this is maybe, you know, I feel like there's quite a lot of green space here. So perhaps you're already quite lucky. But this study from Denmark, you know, showed the closer you lived to green space, the less likely you were to develop mental health problems later in life. And access to nature has also been linked to things like improved sleep, reduced stress. Green environments can apparently boost your thinking. There's so much evidence about, you know, the benefits of being outside. This study is just one of example of it. And really forward-thinking cities are actually starting to think much more about how they prioritise nature and green spaces. So lots and lots of, you know, cities across the world, Melbourne, Paris, are starting to launch what they call like tree canopy campaigns to make more green spaces. The one I just want to show you is Shenzhen in China. Now, this is actually not what it looks like. This is a, what do I say, an artist's mock-up. So it's a little bit misleading. But the thing I want to tell you is that they are trying to make the shift from GDP to GEP, where GEP, and I'm just checking I'm saying this right, is gross ecosystem product. So instead of measuring GDP, what they're going to start measuring is the impact that green spaces and natural spaces and shared spaces have on people's health. So they're going to think more about the contributions to the local economy that these things have rather than the conventional GDP. So it's just something that they're sort of trialing, and it's actually very interesting that it's China that's trialing this as well. But they really want to think about, you know, what makes a city successful. It is actually for them now not GDP. It is potentially going to be GEP. So this next trend is all about urban restoration and how a city is really more than a place to live. Future urban spaces are going to need to actively promote well-being, allow citizens to slow down and turn urban living into urban healing. And you know, lots and lots of people are looking for alternative ways of life, looking to, you know, escape much more sort of concrete cities into cities that still offer them all the benefits of a city, but that actually maybe are better for their health. So is there a way to position yourself and think about that? So let's look at a few innovations. My first one is actually also from Chicago. So Big Green, who are a non-profit, have partnered with Modern Farmer, who are a sort of, they're a magazine and a movement around, funnily enough, modern farming. And they've launched a campaign to encourage people to grow their own food in Chicago. I was actually talking to somebody just earlier on about, you know, growing their own food and, you know, the sort of sustainability benefits there. But there's also, you know, other sort of layered benefits here. You know, gardening is good for your mental health and good for stress levels. Also, and I know you probably know much better than me about the concept of food deserts and, you know, people not having access to fresh food. So these are both, you know, have those dual benefits of, you know, improving mental health, but also improving access to green foods. And actually, lots and lots of brands are kind of pushing out initiatives like this. Another one is Tazo Tea. So they've partnered with American Forests. It's called the Tazo Tree Corps. So they're doing it in collaboration with a singer and a sort of youth activist to really like make this appeal to young people. And what they really want to do is, you know, fight climate change by encouraging young people to plant trees. So with a particular focus on like disadvantaged neighborhoods, those ones that we talked about where they have less tree canopies. So what they want to do is employ people from typically BIPOC communities, train them in how to plant trees, in tree maintenance, and then basically put them back in their local communities and encourage them to do that sort of thing. So in some ways, it's really, you know, giving people the skills and the knowledge that they need to create change in their own environment, which I also think is really powerful. And it's running in lots and lots of cities across the US. They're going to expand it to Richmond in Vancouver and the Bronx in New York this year. So I was just checking where they were doing that. Okay, another couple more examples I just wanted to show you. So this one is a campaign, actually. So it's from Otrivin. Otrivin are a nasal spray. They wanted to tackle air pollution in Poland. So parts of Poland have some of the highest levels of air pollution in Europe. It's particularly bad for kids, and we know that there's a lot of, you know, health implications linked to air pollution. So they created this playground that has around the outside sort of tubes of algae that can basically use photosynthesis to purify the air. The more kids play and the more the space is used, the more the air moves around and the faster it's purified. That is what the press release told me. I must admit, my knowledge of photosynthesis is not the best. So I don't know if that's actually how it works. If we have anyone here who's a photosynthesis expert, please come and explain to me afterwards if I am making this example a little misleading, but that's what they say in the press release. And they're really just trying to obviously make a space that is much better for children, and also tackling an issue that is very prevalent in the country. Again, as we've seen with some of these innovations, you know, this is just a sort of small drop in the ocean, but it could be really powerful if this was maybe done on a much broader scale or on a community scale. And just two more examples here. So this one is actually from the UK. ASICS are a big sports brand that you might have heard of. And Mind are a non-profit in the UK that is focused on helping people with mental health issues. So they really want to encourage better health through movement. Actually quite similar to the Nike example. But I'm just going to show you the video, because what they actually did was they did it on a community-wide scale.
Can movement lift the mood of a whole town? Welcome to Retford, a small town with a very small mood rating. It badly needed an uplift. But how? By turning benches into bench presses. Lampposts into goalposts, and bus stops into bus steps. Introducing Upliftford, an ASICS experiment to prove the uplifting power of sport. For one joyous, sweaty day, Retford has exercised like never before. The result? We turn this into this. A whopping 27% mood uplift. And if movement can uplift Retford, imagine what it can do for the world. ASICS, sound mind, sound body.
And so Mind is the charity that it was done in support of, and all of the profits that they made from the event were donated to the charity. I think the thing I like about that is obviously the community-wide aspect. They really sort of did as much as possible to make it as inclusive to as many people as possible. And also that idea of, you know, people being able to visualise through the ASICS face map at all, you know, how exercise and how participating in something communal had actually had a positive impact on them, could also encourage people to do those kinds of things in the future. And just one final thing to say here is that, you know, lots and lots of new cities, you know, or new urban areas, not even necessarily cities, are really being built with healing embedded from the ground up. And just one I wanted to show you is Southlands, which is just outside of Toronto in Canada. So they call it an agrihood, which is quite an awkward portmanteau of words, but it's an agricultural neighbourhood. So the idea is that suburban farming is suburban living is linked with farming. So it's about encouraging people to be more connected to their food. But also it's kind of trying to build a small space. Perhaps you're familiar with the idea of 15-minute cities, which is something that the mayor of Paris is, you know, very into. The idea that everything you need is within a 15-minute walk or bike ride from where you are. And so they're building these around this as well. And they're also trying to encourage the farming, you know, to become, you know, a farmer's market. They're trying to like really turn it into something that is a very sustainable ecosystem. So in the process of being built, they've actually opened the first phase. They're starting to open the second phase. And when I was re-researching this example for this presentation, I realised that they've actually just opened applications and purchasing for the second phase. And what I found when I was reading about it was that people actually were so desperate to have a plot at Southlands that they actually spent the night outside waiting for everything to go on sale so that they could be first in the line to get the house that they wanted in this agrihood, because they only released them in quite small batches. So there's clearly, you know, demand for this kind of living. So perhaps that's definitely a way to think about building future places as well. So urban restoration. Could you work with local artists and designers to incorporate fun and spontaneity into city life? That could mean, as we saw with the Retford example, you know, reframing walkways, trees, open spaces, footpaths into spaces for informal recreation. In Europe, pedestrian-friendly slow streets that limit vehicle access to make space for other activities are attracting interest. What they're finding as well is that, you know, the businesses that are on those streets are seeing an uplift in profits too. So there's lots and lots of benefits for, you know, thinking about cities in a new way. So there we have it. That is the end of this megatrend. So as usual, I'm going to give you a couple of minutes to talk about this trend with the person sitting next to you, and then we will go on to a completely different mega trend. So, sorry to interrupt your conversations. That is definitely another theme of the day, right? If I do it once more, it'll be a trend. I have a roving microphone reporter at the back of the room. Does anybody have any thoughts about Age of Healing that they would like to share? Have they solved a big problem with this mega trend? I mean, in 2 minutes, we'd all be very impressed, I think. But any early thoughts, any innovations that stayed with you? Would anyone like to share? Oh, yes, please. If you just hang on, just wait for... Sorry.
Oh, the microphone.
Thank you.
I got really excited watching that. At Fallon, we opened our lifestyle medicine team this a couple months ago for both our employees and the public, but it really focuses on the six dimensions of health and well-being, including stress, movement, activity. And I think about all the ways that we can build upon that, that and in partnership with our relationship with the Packers and the Titletown campus and many others that are in the room. I think that Green Bay is very well positioned to put ourselves on the map as the examples that, that you had shared with us.
Yeah, no, I think that's very true.
And we have so much green space here.
Yes, yeah, I'm very jealous. Well, there we go. If you've got questions about this mega trend and you want someone to collaborate with, maybe there's someone on there over here who can help that. Any other points anyone would like to raise? No? Okay, we're all good. I will. Thank you, Steve. I will move on to the last mega trend. And as I said, this one is very different. So it's called metaphysical. Phil mentioned the word metaverse at the start of the day, if you can remember that far back. And I just wondered if I could see a quick show of hands. Who here has heard of the metaverse? Okay. Who here thinks they know what it means? Okay, slightly less. That's good. We're here to solve it together. So the word metaverse has actually been around for a really long time. A fairly long time. It was coined in 1992 by an author called Neil Stephenson in a book that he wrote. And it basically describes, you know, a fully digital world where we sort of play and interact and work across sort of a digital time and space continuum. Now, there's lots and lots of ideas about what this might actually look like. There's, of course, you know, avatars, and there's virtual reality, augmented reality, which is sort of the mixing of things, technologies that we haven't even developed yet. So that's what I'm really going to concentrate on this one. So we've got lots and lots of technology to finish off with. And perhaps, you know, your knowledge of the word metaverse might have come from Mark Zuckerberg. Facebook is rebranding as Meta. So they are making a big push for this metaverse. Whether or not that is tied to declining usage of Facebook, one can only speculate. If you haven't seen any of the Facebook announcement, you know, into the metaverse, you should watch it because it's really one of the most awkward brand announcements I think I've ever seen. And also, I feel like that's Mark Zuckerberg's avatar. I mean, he could have made himself a bit more exciting in the digital world as well, couldn't he? I mean, I do also wear black a lot of the time, so I can't really criticize him too much. But anyway, so yeah, we're seeing this idea of, you know, the metaverse kind of starting to move into people's consciousness. Now, I really just want to highlight how COVID, you know, accelerated digital transformation. You know, we saw years of progress, you know, crammed into, you know, 18 months, 2 years, in, you know, almost every market. Adoption acceleration, you know, up 3 years on a global scale. In Asia Pacific, it was actually up, you know, 4 years, and so on. There's lots of research actually from McKinsey about this kind of thing if you want to dig into it a little bit more. But, you know, look, digital acceleration brings with it lots of challenges and, you know, lots of interesting sort of social concepts.
Mr. Ponton, I believe you have a filter turned on in the video settings. You might want to
can you hear me, Judge?
I can hear you. I think it's a filter.
It is, and I don't know how to remove it. I've got my assistant here. She's trying to, but I'm prepared to go forward with it. I'm here live. I'm not a cat.
I can see that. I think if you click the up arrow next to this.
I mean, comedy gold, right? This was definitely unplanned. The lawyer, Rod Ponton, actually became like a very viral sensation. I also like the way he says, "I'm not a cat," thereby sort of introducing the idea that maybe we might have thought he was a cat. But anyway, so there we go. Look, you know, the route to digital is fraught with challenges. And I should also tell you that this video has been repeated many, many times online. You know, it's obviously very funny, it's very silly. The original one, you know, that's the viewership for the original one. So there we go. Internet sensation. So look, obviously we saw him, the lawyer there, get stuck with the cat filter on his face. You know, filters and all these kinds of things are really popular on social media networks like Snapchat and TikTok. Digital self-expression is really very interesting, and you know, filters and all the sorts of things that, you know, I use in my presentations, like GIFs and memes that are really popular online, are really allowing a new kind of digital expression. You know, people can communicate quite complex things in non-verbal ways. Obviously, it helps if you don't look like a cat while you're doing it. but, you know, and particularly young people are very adept in like new digital languages, emojis, whether you love them or hate them, you know, all of these kinds of new digital languages. Also, interestingly enough, you know, many people feel like, you know, the most important group they are part of operates online. You know, lots of people do find belonging and meaning in online groups. Now, not to say that, you know, the internet in general and the metaverse isn't, you know, without its dark side. You know, we've all seen things about like gaming addiction, for example. You know, lots of problems that already exist in the real world are translating into the digital world. Facebook actually just had to introduce a sort of a guard space for avatars in the metaverse. So for like digital people in the metaverse, you can now put a guard space around you to avoid sort of digital harassment, because what they were finding was that, you know, in the digital space, people were, other characters or other avatars were getting too close, and, you know, people were, you know, having sort of, you know, personal boundary issues. So, you know, we're starting to see, you know, issues that we find in the real world, you know, are just being translated into the digital world. So there's lots and lots and lots of things to unpack about the negative side, and I could definitely spend the rest of my session today doing that. But look, we're going to find the opportunities. We're going to find the double rainbow. so let's think a little bit about a few more ways that the metaverse is kind of coming into play. So way back in 2016 at Trendwatching, we started tracking something live streaming platforms, basically in Asia. And what we started seeing was, you know, young people used to live stream themselves eating inhumane amounts of spicy food, okay? So this is called mukbang. It's from South Korea. And people just tuned in to watch, right? And they didn't just eat spicy foods. They did lots and lots of brainless things that other people just watched. And it just got really successful really very quickly in Asia. And of course, you know, it didn't take long for people to start thinking, hey, there's money-making potential here. So this enterprising individual in China, he started live streaming the harvesting of mussels. You could bet whether or not there was a pearl inside it, and if you won, you earned some money. He actually made $4 million in the process of doing this. So it was pretty enterprising. And of course, where there's money to be made, brands follow. So Taobao, if you're not familiar with them, they're kind of the Amazon of Asia, for the very easiest explanation of them. They saw the demand for live streaming and they started to add a commerce layer to it. So not only could you watch, you know, something being live streamed, you could buy the products that you saw in the live stream at the same time. And this really took off in China, you know. And especially during the pandemic, where lots of businesses were not open, you know, all sorts of people started selling via live streaming. You could buy tractors via live streaming, okay? Like there was, like, we're not just talking FMCG, beauty, things like that, you know, real estate as well. You know, the array of things that you can buy via live stream in China is really quite mind-boggling. And of course, you know, if you are thinking, okay, well, the pandemic, that was a bit of a special time. Are people still live stream shopping in China? The answer is yes. So last year, Singles Day, which is sort of the Chinese equivalent of Black Friday, The number two live streamer for e-commerce sold nearly $1.7 billion of stuff in 12 hours, 26 minutes. I'm not sure where this leaves me with the unconsumed megatrend we started with. I do appreciate that there's a bit of a bump there. But let's overlook that for the moment. So look, it's time to forget business as usual. It is time for business as social, because what we're seeing is live streaming is driving global expectations for consumption that isn't convenient, but is also communal, is also fun, is also experiential. And really, this is going to extend far, far, far beyond retail. And look, to bring this a little bit closer to home, you know, Facebook, now Meta, are experimenting with shopping via live stream. So, you know, you can tune into live streams on Facebook that are often hosted by celebrities, and you can buy products from it. TikTok are doing a very similar thing in partnership with Shopify, where you can basically have a storefront that is linked to your TikTok account, so you can buy through TikTok. So, you know, look, Western social media brands are starting to kind of go down this route as well. TikTok actually is going to rank as the third largest social network in 2022. You know, it's enjoying really phenomenal success, overtaken, you know, Twitter and Snapchat. Young people really love lots of things about TikTok, the silly dance routines. And so obviously there's a lot of innovation in that space, you know, trying to capture the Gen Z market. And that includes shopping while they are there. And look, it seems like we can't help but shop while we are on social media. 71% of people agree that social media platforms have inspired them to make purchases even when they weren't looking to shop. The algorithm is sneaky, is all I can say. So yeah, there is definitely this appetite to shop, and we're seeing this link. Now, obviously, big brands in Europe and the US are starting to get involved. Walmart are pushing really heavily into social commerce. They have live streamed shopping content on 8 different platforms: TikTok, YouTube, Instagram. This is something that they're really pushing. They work often actually with founders. So this kind of, the content is the founder maybe talking about their business story or about the inspiration for their brand. And then you can just buy the products at the same time. So you can see this kind of link between entertainment and commerce and how the line is becoming quite blurry. Snapchat as well, they have sort of lenses where you can try on products from brands like Ulta and MAC Cosmetics. So it means you can try the product on virtually. It uses augmented reality, so you can superimpose it over your face. You can see how it might look, and then you can buy it in the app. Right? So that idea of, you know, commerce that is really social and is really engaging. And the thing is that, you know, AR is really popular on Snapchat. It's used 6 billion times a day. So, you know, there's definite demand here. But the thing I want to say is this isn't just about taking a social media platform, TikTok, Instagram, Snapchat, and just like slapping a buy now button on it. That is really just the start, you know. This is really about creating online commerce experiences that are social, that are communal, that are maybe the kind of things that you might have had in the real world previously, translating that to the digital world. So for example, last year when it was, you know, not maybe possible to go shopping for back to school clothes together, Levi's created like a virtual closet where people, it was almost a little bit like being on a Zoom call, but it wasn't hosted on Zoom, where you could shop with your friends, you could like look at products together, you could purchase them, you could talk about the products in the same way that you might go to the shop and do those things. Obviously, this was a reaction to, you know, not being able to shop in person because of pandemic restrictions, but people are really enjoying these experiences. Also as well, you know, social commerce as a concept is really big in, you know, lots and lots of markets, particularly in Brazil. In Brazil, there's also a lot of emphasis on shopping together online to get discounts, not necessarily just to have fun. So there's a popular social commerce app there called Fácil. They just raised, as you can see, $366 million at the end of last year to kind of keep pushing their social commerce. But as I say, theirs is less about using AR and having more entertainment, and more about finding other people who want the same things as you in terms of produce, bringing you all together and helping you get the best price. The final innovation I just want to talk about here is Klarna. So we've talked about them already today. They're the buy now, pay later platform. Now, this example is a little convoluted to explain, so bear with me. But so Klarna, buy now, pay later platform. They partnered with several influencers to create an in-game shopping experience on Animal Crossing. Now, Animal Crossing was a game that was really popular. It's from Nintendo. It was really popular during the pandemic because it's this beautiful, idyllic world where you can create beautiful, beautiful scenarios, clearly a bit of escapism. So they made this online collection available within the game. What you could also do is if you shared images of yourself playing the game or interacting with the game, you could then win real world versions of the clothing in the game. So are you all with me? So it's connecting all of the dots. And I think the thing that just to say here is that Klarna realized that people jump in and out of a gaming world, out of a social media world, out of the real world, and they are there with them wherever they go, which is really very interesting and really very powerful and really something to think about, I think, for the future when it comes to branding. So business as social. This isn't, as I said, about just taking a social media channel and saying buy now. It's about how can you build commerce solutions that are communal and experiential. Okay, let's talk a little bit more about gaming. Obviously, video gaming is incredibly popular. One thing I just wanted to say about gaming is, and we talked about a little bit with the skate park, is, you know, when you think about a stereotypical gamer, you maybe think young, male, 16 to 24. Now look, that is still the biggest proportion of gamers, but lots of elderly people are gaming too. Perhaps because, you know, gaming now doesn't mean you have to have three screens and a fancy chair and you're shooting people. You know, gaming, you can now play games on your phone, you can play them on your iPad. You know, there's much more accessible routes into gaming. So it means that lots more people are playing video games. I'm not sure if you've heard of Wordle, right? The game of the moment, the one that everybody wants to talk about. It's a game where you have to, you know, you have so many chances to guess a word. It was actually just made by a developer, and it got purchased by the New York Times for quite a lot of money and also for quite a lot of controversy. I think a lot of true Wordle hardcore fans were not happy about that. But look, don't be fooled by the word game when I say gaming with relation to video games. You know, yes, these are a place for fun and escapism, but they're also a place for self-expression. You can dress your avatar up in different ways. They're also a place for connection as well. You, 61% of UK adults played games with friends and family to stay in touch during lockdowns. So really, gaming is becoming like a third space. You know, the game is a place where you go to hang out with your friends, you go to do things with other people in a virtual setting. And game developers are continually pushing, you know, what is a game? This is an image from Fortnite. You know, Fortnite are one of those games that are really pushing what the future of gaming is. And just a quick quote from someone who is a partner at quite a high profile VC fund. You know, gaming is replacing not just old games, but also TV and Netflix. You know, people are having really engaging experiences in there. And it's kind of replacing a lot of traditional media for them. So this next trend is called virtual experience economy, and it's all about how, you know, in these virtual experiences, you can collect really rare and really surprising experiences, just like you would in the real world. So one example of that is you can now attend concerts within video games. So Ariana Grande hosted a concert within Fortnite. Fortnite is that game I was just telling you about. So it was a 15-minute concert. It was repeated across 5 time zones, so everyone in the world basically had the opportunity to attend it. And it's actually very similar to a real-world concert. You could buy in-game merchandise for your avatar to wear, just like you might buy a t-shirt when you were at a stadium if you went to a real-world concert. But it's also a lot more accessible. If you wanted to see Ariana Grande in Madison Square, it was about $240 a ticket, right? It's pretty expensive. So this is also making that experience a lot more accessible. And I think quite loud, so just brace yourselves. I've just got a little video.
I love you. I know that's not the way to start a conversation. Trouble. I watch them other girls when they come and bug you. But I felt like I knew you, so I just wanted to hug you. Plus, you don't know your way around. You can stop your playing now. All your worries laying down. I don't want to wake up.
That's enough of that. But what you can see is the people that were on those like floating unicorns, they are actually other players. So that's other people playing the game. Obviously, this is like a recording of it, so it's kind of like a cleaned up like version. But yeah, the idea is that you are a participator in the experience. And lots of brands are starting to get involved as well. So Roblox is another game that's very similar to Fortnite. It's like a sandbox game. Nike have created a space in Roblox, which is very much inspired by the Nike headquarters.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Sometimes we laugh, sometimes we cry, but I guess you know now. Baby, been waking up in the crib, and sometimes I don't even know where I'm at. Tired of beefing you bones, you can't even pay me enough to react. And I've never been embraced, and the money's hard to make, so I bet they on their face right now. I know that they at the crib, going crazy, down bad. What they had didn't last, damn baby. Sometimes we laugh, sometimes we cry, but I guess you know now. Baby, we took a trip, now we on your block, and it's like a ghost town. Baby.
So increasingly, it's not just enough to have a presence in the digital world, you have to have a presence in the physical world, you have to have a presence in the digital world as well. And that's Nike's kind of way of starting to move into that. And what one thing I think is actually really interesting as well is you can convert, if you've got like a Nike band, you can actually convert your real world action into game top-ups. So for example, if you go for a run, you can, in the real world, you can then use that to sort of supercharge your character in the digital world. So they're sort of also starting to make those connections between real and digital. H&M debuted an all vegan collection inside Animal Crossing as well. But look, just in case you think I'm getting too frivolous, you know, I actually think that there is a potential here for education as well. So for example, right, financial literacy, you know, financial literacy rates are declining, young people, I mean, I don't know if it's just young people now. I don't think I was that interested in financial literacy when I was like 16. But what you can now do is you can learn about financial literacy in Minecraft. So Ali Financial have created a space in Minecraft that introduces people to, or young people particularly, to concepts like stocks and shares, like the stock exchange. You know, things that always seem quite abstract when you're quite young and it's kind of hard to get into grips with. And look, you know, when we think about, you know, what is happening in the metaverse, there are lots and lots of, you know, sort of promises about what's going to happen here. For example, the Seoul Metropolitan Government want to be the first city to join the metaverse. So the idea is that instead of going to City Hall to register whatever you need to register, you will go to a City Hall within the metaverse to register these things. You know, if they have a town meeting, it will be held in the metaverse and so on. Now look, they're at the very early stages of rolling this out. The full expansion is expected in 2026. But they do already actually have a long history of using technology within government. They have an AI chatbot that can help you with issues that you might have. So they were already thinking in this way. This is one of the sort of the governors. I'm not sure if the governor is the right word, but yeah, you could go and talk to his avatar with your avatar and get information. And you know, look, all sorts of people are stepping into the metaverse arena. This was a New York City mayoral candidate who launched a Meta campaign in June 2021. He held press conferences there, obviously trying to get in touch with younger audiences, you know, campaigning in the metaverse. But hey, you know, maybe we can get digital avatars to do our work for us. I don't know, maybe that's just me. But is this the future of political campaigns, right? Just something to think about. So how will you join consumers and citizens in the digital third space? Who could you collaborate with to enter? Because often a partnership could be a quickest point to entry. You know, it would be very expensive to build a lot of these things from scratch. So you can see how Nike and H&M are building on games that are already there. Okay, just one more thing to quickly talk you through, because I'm aware I'm 2 minutes over. What we're also seeing as well is that, as I talked about with the Ariana Grande concert, you could buy a t-shirt for your avatar. It's the proper word for that is a skin. Virtual objects are starting to become a source of status too. You know, just as in the way that real world objects are a source of status, we're starting to see virtual objects become a source of status. So for example, you know, maybe you could tell other gamers that you were at the Ariana Grande concert because you had the t-shirt. Now, one thing I'm just going to very quickly touch on is NFTs. So if this is also another thing that is a pain to explain. So NFT stands for something called a non-fungible token. So non-fungible tokens exist on the blockchain. It means that you are able to verify ownership of things. So if you own the NFT, you kind of own the original digital copy, if that makes sense. Now, there's been a real explosion of interest in NFTs because they are tied to the metaverse. What you can see on my screen is a digital artwork from a digital artist called Beeple. Now, this was actually sold at Christie's, which is a very high-profile auction house in London, where they've sold like some of the most important master's paintings ever. They actually sold the sort of original digital artwork here. And I was just wondering if anybody knew or could guess how much it sold for.
2 million.
2 million?
12 million.
No. Higher?
40.
Higher?
A billion?
Lower.
Oh.
69 million, right? So this is for like a digital, this actually doesn't exist, right? You can't take your Rembrandt home and put it on your wall. What you can do is you can put it on your wall of your virtual home, okay? Or you can, you know, show it off to other people in the virtual world. Now look, what I should say is NFT, massive, massive overhype, okay? But I think there's something interesting there about the future of possessions and the future of ownership. You know, this bubble is definitely going to burst, okay? You know, there's something to be said about owning the first NFT that was ever auctioned at Christie's that probably helped push the price of this up beyond the hype value of NFTs in the first place. But just to quickly think about, you know, this idea of people wanting to build customized and sophisticated digital personas could drive interest in virtual products and possessions. So for example, Ralph Lauren, obviously a pretty famous brand, they partnered with Zepeto. Zepeto is a social network in South Korea to create a digital clothing collection. So this is the video that they used to create it. So they also created their own sort of brand experience. You could go to visit the Ralph Lauren store in the digital world. You could buy Ralph Lauren products, and then your avatar could wear them. One thing to say here, particularly for luxury brands, is that obviously, you know, if you were to buy, and sorry, I'm not very good at doing the conversion, but if you were to buy like a Ralph Lauren dress, for example, that might cost you like £300. Here, it is costing you significantly less, like a couple of pounds instead. So it is. There's also something interesting there about accessibility. You know, you can also buy virtual Gucci trainers as well that you can wear in augmented reality. They're kind of a bit bright for my liking, but hey, I'm just telling you they're out there. I'm not saying we should be wearing them. And there's all sorts of, you know, experiments around, you know, digital fashion. This is a mobile shopping game where you can collect virtual sneakers. And you can also buy virtual sneakers from brands like Chanel, Nike, Balenciaga. Obviously, sneakerheads has a huge fandom and a huge following. You know, people get really passionate about sneakers. So obviously, this isn't something that everyday people are, you know, are really engaging with. But for some people, you know, this is where they are already at and how they are thinking about the future. And the founder actually says the biggest opportunity for physical goods is virtual goods. Now, I don't necessarily know if that is true. I think that is very much true of the moment that we are at with the metaverse, because it feels very easy to relate it to our current experience. But I'm just sort of just opening your eyes to these things being out there. So I guess this really kind of sums it up a little bit. People are spending more time online. That's creating a new kind of virtual living that encompasses digital possessions and social spaces. Brands need to be a part of these digital social spaces because that's where people are working, they are shopping, they are living, you know. So maybe virtual possessions aren't the future, but digital spaces are definitely the future, and people living in them are definitely the future. 93% of people agree that technology is our future, and the online and offline worlds are going to continue to blur and reflect each other. On one stat that I saw just last week, by 2026, 25% of people will have spent at least 1 hour a day in the metaverse for work, shopping, education, social and entertainment purposes. I mean, that's just one prediction, but it definitely is a very clear point of where, you know, think tanks like Gartner think we are heading. And the Gartner vice president said that brands, and I'm just going to read my notes, will need to collaborate in order to unify the metaverse as their users continue to demand virtual, interactive, three-dimensional experiences. So there we have it. That was our last two megatrends. Very different two, right? We talked about the age of healing and metaphysical. These are all of the trends that we have been through together today. We started with unconsumed, we looked at glassbox brands, age of healing, and of course, metaphysical. Now, I was going to get you to combine these trends and come up with ideas, but I am definitely out of time for that, so we won't do that. We won't hear ideas, but do come and tell me if you have any ideas afterwards, because I would love to hear them. Hopefully I have given you some glimpses into the future. Hopefully you don't feel too much like this. But hopefully it's given you some food for thought, and it's given you lots of starting points for conversations to continue, because don't forget that the light bulb moments were the most important thing. That is all from me. Thank you so much for listening and for your attention. I'm going to...